shocked with her experience how little infrastructure there is with online education. Like whether it's state run or whether it's private companies, the state of online education is really needs a lot of help. So the first thing that I like to say is when I, yeah, that one's a lot of private jets, of private jets around
here.
Orange County, yes. Yeah, yeah. So it's very inspiring. It's really cool to see them come by. I like flying into John Wayne, and you see like just decks of private jets over there, and it's really cool. Yeah. It's very inspiring. So, but yeah, to get back to the point, the online education infrastructure is really set up like in an archaic fashion. It's like not very engaging, and the way that it's set up, because we chose to make an app, and we chose our app to have short end video in the front side of it. That way it keeps it really engaging. The problem with live video, because all of our lessons are live, is if you have the whole platform be live, we see with Clubhouse, the engagement is really off. So for us, it was really important to have a strong front end engagement system. And the other problem with having a web page set up is when you go to Google, you think everything on the front page is all the good stuff. And the farther you go down the pages, the worse the content is, or the less legitimate or less worth your time. Well, if you have teachers set up in this fashion, it's just simply not true. Yep. The teacher on page 88 is just as excited and eager and willing and committed to teach you, but they're viewed as lesser. So that model itself is not good. So really being inspired by different forms of short video played in the front end and having the engagement being strong right away was really the inspiration for the short end video.
Yeah.
And then we did a lot of consultation with teachers. Like I had a teacher friend in South America in Chile, or excuse me, Argentina. And she's a wonderful Spanish teacher. But her problem was, how do I get clients in this situation right now with the pandemic going on? I can't really meet people right now. And locally, she charges $4 an hour, which I don't really think is a fair rate in the world. We have like fair trade and all these wonderful things pushing for it to be better. But I think we can do a lot better in the world. I think someone in America would be very excited to learn Spanish from a Spanish teacher in Argentina. But she doesn't know how to get clients. She doesn't know how to collect payment. She doesn't know how to schedule the different time zones. And she doesn't know which video to do the live lesson on. So with Teachagram, we put all of that into one app. And that's our major goal. And currently, we're at our MVP stage. So it's been very exciting. It's been a year and a half in the making right now. So.
Amazing.
Yeah, a lot of information there, but
no. But this is great, and for a year, that means during COVID.
Yeah, during COVID,
the process of creating this idea and going through some of the challenges, which was learning about the industry, learning about the challenges of online education.
Oh yeah,
it took you a while, obviously, and there's some undercover that you had to do, right?
Yeah,
so can you talk a little bit about some of that strategy of to really put yourself in the shoes of not only the teacher, but to also understand what do students really want. When you're talking about online education. So can you talk a little bit about that?
For sure, you know, when Sora came back December of 2019 and I came back from Thailand January 4th or 5th of 2020, she already has been homeschooled, online schooled, every version of online / homeschooled there is. And she knew, like everyone was focused on the COVID-19, the pandemic, the jobs and all of those things, but my sister knew what that's going to have that effect on with students. What's that mental health effect that's going to have as well? So it was, she knew right away, oh, we need to work on a solution for these people, because the other thing is we're always thinking, when will we go back to normal? But everything becomes a new normal. After every big global shift in the world, we don't fully revert back to where we were before. Yeah. So listening to her, understanding the strategy, understanding that it will be popular and the demand is there, immediately we say, okay, we got to go into the product. So the product being teachers and students, well, you already done the student side. So I went and became I probably made a lot of noise there. I became an underground teacher. So I joined a few different avenues. I applied to a few of them that I liked. Some of them I didn't like. Like you couldn't adjust the financial model, which I didn't like that. I feel like you should decide what you want to charge and what your worth is. And if the market says yes, you're worth that, then who am I to judge on that? And also a lot of those markets were set where if you're in the Philippines, for example, you should charge less. I don't believe that to be the case. I think we should all charge what we feel like we're worth, and if people reciprocate that, then that's good on them. So I found a few that did that. And then I wanted ones that had low barrier to entry. Yesterday, or the day before yesterday, we had a meeting with maybe 30 or 40 like VC people that were very cool and exciting, and they were really stuck on the academic portion of it. Oh, you need everyone with accolades and these degrees to teach everybody math, science. And I was like, okay, but what if we have a chef? Do they have to be cordon bleu or whatever the ranking is to teach me how to, my mother taught me how to cook, and my mom's a wonderful chef, but she doesn't have a degree in it. And I've helped a lot of people through math. I don't have like super high degrees in specifically in math, but I felt like I was good at helping her. I helped her with a lot of her homework as well. So I think the intention, I think we really missed the point. And sometimes in less privileged areas, we don't have as much access to all those things as well. The certifications, getting a TOEFL certificate, getting an SAT, GRE, GMAT, all these different things. A lot of people are willing to help you through those different kinds of academically, and also there's no certificate for skateboarding that I know of. So if you wanted to learn that, then do you have to be a professional skateboarder to help someone do an ollie? I said ollie, I don't know what that means. That's the only trick I know. Yeah. But so after finding like a more flexible site, there wasn't one available. I found one in English. And I dug down, and in 5 days, I was the number one recruiter in North America, number three in the world. And then in the next day, there was like a scouting system. So I got scouted by my, I guess, mentor, quote unquote. And then I started mentoring teachers a month after that. And then I made $12,000 total in 2 months. So I did about $5,000 a month doing, that was 407 lessons, so 407 hours. So, I was working, pretty hard, but it was really to figure out the problems. And the problem is there's zero consideration for the teachers. Everything is about the business, money. Yeah. And it was just, it was really hard to see that there was no infrastructure for teachers. There's no guidance, there's no metrics, no analytics. I didn't know how many people I spoke to. I didn't know how many people I were converting into real students. I didn't know how many people I was reaching. Just basic analytics that you would normally have were not there. So taking care of the back end and figuring out how we could best make a great experience for the teachers was very important. And then when I was tutoring teachers how to teach, it was a lot of fun. The biggest thing was, I'm not social. I'm scared. I don't know how to talk to people. I don't think I'll be a good teacher. I really like this subject, but I don't really think I can do this. And, I don't think that you have to be social. I help them distinguish a little difference. You can be antisocial, you can be introverted, but you can still have great connection. It's like if two introverted people got married, are we saying that they're not gonna have a great relationship, that they cannot have one because they're not social? No, I think connection is something that you don't need to learn how to have. If you bump into someone in UCI and you're just like, I don't know why, but we just click and I like you, And I don't know if it's the shoes you're wearing or like what you said at that class or how you stood up to that guy, but I love you and I want to hang out with you. That's not something you need to be extremely social for. Yeah. The way I described that was kind of social, but you can do it in a way, with little note passing, little like Morse code, but it's something that you don't need to be taught how to have is a connection. Yeah. So in our lessons, it's really important to have one-on-one lesson time is what you discovered as well. Because if you're in a classroom of 20, you kind of like let all the people that talk a lot talk.
What I found was when I'm in a class where it's not just me and the teacher, it doesn't feel like a class. It feels like I'm watching YouTube. And personally, as you can tell, I'm the introverted sibling. I like to let my brother talk because it's just my personality. It's just who I am. So when I did take the classes, I did the student part of the research. So I made sure that this is something that the student would have fun as well. And what I found was, not just me, but when I was in a group setting, most students were not willing to reach out. If a teacher said, does anyone know the answer to this question, most students would look at each other waiting for the other to answer. Yeah. Me included, I did not want to answer first. I didn't want to turn my mic on first. I didn't even like the action of having to unmute myself because that felt pressuring. So I thought that in order to have the most connection, the most real connection, and the most willing connection, one-on-one is important. it's important because you're talking not to a screen, not to a class, but to someone who's willing to listen to you, who's only listening to you, and who's not judging you. So I thought one-on-one was a very important aspect that we should keep. And a lot of people, when they're thinking about the app, they feel really pressured, right? They're like, oh, what if I don't draw well enough? Or what if I don't, you know, sing well enough? But you don't have to be this super talented American Got Talent singer. Yeah. You just have to be a little bit better than me. And that's the whole point of it. We're just helping the community grow off of each other. So that was mainly what I wanted to get across on the student end.
Yeah. When she told me that, it's tough. It's tough when you try to build a business model that is purely one-on-one and you go try to talk to YouTubers and like TikTokers. Like we met that at that event, there was like the one we went to together. There was like this guy at like 50 million, whatever, TikTokers, whatever. Mm-hmm. They all want to try to figure out how they can use your system as a funnel towards for themselves. So all of the people that are really popular and stuff, it's already not a model for them. And developing that one-on-one model, it really had to become our philosophy and our belief system in order to, every conversation we talk, every time we bring in something new, it's more line extension, more, okay, well, if we had two people in the class, then you make double the money, right? And it just kept going on and on. And the main model is that, as every other platform is built to become a popularity contest first, and then even then you don't make any income off of it. Like even if you're super famous on YouTube,
Instagram,
if you have a million, I believe the statistic is if you have a million subscribers on YouTube, you make roughly $60,000 a year from AdSense. So, and only 0.005% of all of YouTube makes that much. So it's set up for, it's set up for a very small amount to be successful. So for Twitch streamers, for example, you have to have 500 Twitch streamers, or excuse me, 500 subscribers watching your live. Like when you're on, you have to have 500 people watching for you to consider, okay, maybe I make this a career. YouTube, you need more, and TikTok, you need way more. Their numbers are astronomically high. And then you still don't make money from the platform. You make money from sponsorships and indirectly from being famous. And most people, we've come to learn, unlike what Instagram makes us believe, where everybody is super extroverted, most people in the world are not super extroverted. Most people in the world would not be comfortable in their shoes. So setting up a business model only for people that would win a popularity contest seems very unjust and unfair. A lot of people just want to teach their clients online or their students online. So it was, it was a business model that we found was very healthy, and especially in this climate where everyone is very concerned about the mental health of people and related to apps. On this particular app, you fill up your schedule. There's no reason for you to keep being on the app. You're done. Oh, I filled up my hours that I want to learn, or I filled up my hours I want to teach. Put the app away. It rings you when it's time to teach or time to have your lesson. So it's not supposed to suck all your time all day long and have you watching all these content that may or may not be good for you in the long run.
Yeah.
So that was very important as far as the business model, which stemmed from your need that you felt that many people would benefit from.
Yeah, and let's talk a little bit real quickly. So that's customer discovery. You went in, you did exactly what you're supposed to do. Sometimes this is what happens to entrepreneurs. You come up with a great idea, like Max was saying, we all have great ideas, but it's that execution that matters. And that's when you have to get out of your head, get out of your room, and go out there and figure out what's really the problem. And so one lesson to just learn through this is that they could have not went out there and tried to play teacher student. They could have just said, you know, the data says what it says. Like you learned that already before you stepped in. You knew that the data said that, you know, this is not really working anyways. And when you're going on the websites, they were already archaic anyhow.
Yeah.
So we knew for sure that online education has had a problem. And for those who obviously went in from COVID into the Zoom world after, you know, COVID happened, you can imagine that you had a struggle. And I'm sure I can probably raise of hands that everyone had some form of a struggle. Either it was time management or either it was being bored because the lessons were just weren't feeling very humanistic. It wasn't feeling like it was connecting to you. There had to be some version of that that you guys could fix. And obviously that kind of what happened with you, Sora. Like, I don't want to go too far back, but I know that you had mentioned that you just wanted someone just a little smarter than you just to teach you a little bit of something else that you wanted to learn. So can you share just a little bit about why it didn't matter how professional you were, it didn't matter how great you are, just show me a little bit about what I want to learn. Can you talk a little bit about that?
What about the manga?
Okay. That's a little personal, but when I was traveling in Korea, I fell in love with manga and Japanese culture, and I really wanted to learn how to draw. And unfortunately, I didn't, even though I'm Korean, I grew up in the States, I don't speak fluent Korean, so I was already pretty isolated from where I was at. And I would try to go out and find a Korean manga tutor. There was none that spoke English, and if they did speak English, they weren't very personable. It was very Google translated. And I tried to find it on YouTube as well. But when I watched YouTube, somehow I felt more lonely, because an ad would pop up when I was watching the video, and I would be reminded, I'd be back in reality, like, I'm alone in my room. I'm talking to basically a comment section, and they're probably not gonna see my comment. And I really don't know what they're doing. I'm just trying to copy what they're showing. And it brought me back to reality. It's like, no, I'm so alone. And I tried to find somewhere that helped me draw manga. I wasn't looking for, like, you know, the top manga artist in Japan or the best ink in the world or the best paper that I could buy. I was just looking for someone to draw with, someone a little bit better than me that can show me a little bit more than I know. And it wasn't available, funny enough. As much as we talk about connection in this world and how we're all connected and, you know, I see you through my screen, it's not as connected as we say. And more than anything, it made me feel more alone than I was. So yeah. I just looked at that and I thought, this is not right. We promote mental health, but there's nothing that's really giving a hand out.
Yeah.
So that was my personal story about little things that I just could not get that I feel like everyone should get.
Thanks for sharing that, though. I mean, and it is personal, so definitely thanks for sharing. But what it reminds me of is it didn't have to be a great idea either. Like, you really just wanted to solve your own problem at the end of the day. And some of the greatest inventions is just solving your own problem. One thing that I wanted to share with you was, even like my son, you know, my son is, he's an outgoing kid, like very outgoing, but when COVID happened, it just started to slowly not be as outgoing, even in the home, like didn't want to talk about certain things. I'm like, what's going on, son, what's going on? And he just started realizing, like, I really just want to just have a call, have a phone call. Just, can I FaceTime my friend? And so we made sure that at least the FaceTime was there, even though we couldn't do much else. It wasn't a learning circumstance, but we had to provide something, just that little bit to help them feel a little bit more comfortable. So what I believe this app can really do, and you guys can speak a little bit more of it, Anyone who has a skill, anyone who wants to teach something, or anyone who wants to learn, can use this app. They can benefit from it, either learning or teaching. So share a little bit more about that, but also more about the other things that you guys are interested in on the app. You said the VCs are so focused on the academic side of it.
Yeah.
What are some other things? Because
I gotta stay away from certain words. When I say certain words, everyone just gets like really excited and wants to say stuff. If I say academic, people get very excited. If I say any kind of like testing related thing, then people get just very hot and bothered. So I just have to. Gotta like avoid that a bit, you know. But to know about why Teachagram is the way it is and to know why we do what we do, it's really important to know us as a family. I think as a family, we've done a lot of business over, you know, a long period of time, and we've traveled to many countries and we saw many situations, and usually it's like a business is something that's not always beautiful. You know, there was many times I learned a lot about humans really from watching my father and mother work and watching people really break what they say metaphorically. If you look at my father's bag, there's like a lot of wounds that come from those who speak very sweet to you but take action against you. For those that promise you that you've kept your promise to, but people don't keep their promise back to you. They don't see him as a family man. They don't see him as a father. They don't see him as a husband. They see him as someone that is in the way, someone that was useful, and then now we need to figure out a way around it. So in a certain way, business can, like those of you that are looking to enter business, business mm-hmm. can be a real fast way to grow up. It can be a really intoxicating yet awakening experience. And if you think that it's a quick process, if you think that it's a exciting and, you know, fruitful and happy process, yeah. it is anywhere, you know, don't worry. It's all good. You would be wrong. It's a place where you grow up. It's a place where you get tough. And it's a place where you really learn about your personal character, what you are willing and not willing to do. It's not really the choices our family makes that we're yeses, but really what we say no to that defines us, yeah. that keeps us proud, that keeps us going in the right direction. Because so many people that were by my side, they ended up going what I would consider not the right direction with things. Prioritizing profit over human, prioritizing personal gain over the sake of the company, sake of others, sake of the customers, speaking ill of customers. I think this is old practices that happen if you don't go past being cynical and go to being brave and trusting. Mm-hmm. So we've had many experiences where we've been hit with earnesty. You know, my mother and father landing in a not as fortunate country and being met with the eyes of a sincere girl or a sincere boy that asks for money or donation. And when they receive it, they say, thank you, brother. And then they go run, and most likely to their siblings, most likely to a child that's alone and younger at home. When you travel, I really encourage everyone, when everything gets a little better, to travel a bit and you really have your eyes awakened. And you don't really need to go that far. You can just travel in your local communities and you really get hit with a different kind of reality. So when you look at them, those less fortunate than you, those that don't have the luxury to complain about what we love to complain about sometimes, then you hit with a new question. What is their solution? Because a lot of times when you meet them, they don't want handouts. They want solutions. They want skill sets. They want education. They want a trade. They want an ability to stand on their own. So when we were facing those situations, and I'll tell you a quick story. I don't want to tell my other family members' stories because I might be sensitive for them, but I go to Korea fairly often, and when you're in Korea by the subway stations, which are, you know, nice and efficient, there's a lot of times we call them like a grandma who has a table laid out full of little things that she wants to sell because she doesn't want to just accept money. And on my last trip on this particular day, I really enjoy this one cookie shop. It's like really, really nice and has this delicious cookies. And there's this juice shop. Well, you guys have it here, I think. Joe the Juice. It's like a nice, yummy juice shop. Mm-hmm. And I remember seeing her every day, and she was there again. So I went in and I wanted to share this cookie with her. So I got her the drink and the cookie, and I handed her the cookie, expecting her just to take it and receive it. And I feel like, you know, I get to share a little bit of experience with you, you know, not just money, but also an experience. And she broke the cookie in half and gave the other half back to me. And I've never been given anything back or received that level of fairness in the workplace or dealing with people ever. So someone who has way less than everyone else that is willing to share and give, it was a very eye-opening experience. And all of our missions from like 7 years ago, we had a project that we worked on, and you know, everything since then, we really asked ourselves, how can we help? How can we reach down as low as possible? Because when I was discussing with one of my friends where they like to have a lot of these initiatives, he said the main two things that hold people back is electricity and education. So right now, a lot of my friends are, they're trying to work on different kind of electricity solutions, but we really believe that it's we can go into the education side of things. And then the other lesson that we learned from the past is, if you try to raise money and you know, you do these charities, they're very good, but they're very also limited. So everyone always talks about being able to scale up, but I focus on, can it scale down? How low can we go and how far can we reach down? And like Uber, they have a nice business model. Airbnb, they have a nice business model where it's kind of a democratized transportation, democratized housing. If you don't have a very nice car, you're limited on what you can Uber with. And if you don't have a nice place, you're limited by your place when you get put on Airbnb. But everyone has a cell phone, well, a lot of people, 4.8 billion cell phones out there. So a lot of cell phones out there. And even a family, if they share a cell phone, you're not limited by, you can not have a car, you can not have a place, and you can sit down anywhere in the world, share your knowledge. If they want to learn your basket weaving, as I saw in some places in Africa, or if you want to learn about particular languages or particular cultures, if you want to learn more about this particular city, you can allow them a chance. Yeah, if you need to go, you can. No worries. No worries. Thank you for coming. You can give them an opportunity to climb up, where like you cannot do that with pretty much anything else right now. So that is the foundation of Teachagram, is that we really want to provide a solution that can reach as many people as possible, provide education to as many people as possible. If you only do register, license, certified teachers for everything, you're going to really limit the amount of people you can reach. So for us, that was a very important part of the platform itself. Absolutely. So that was a long answer, but I think it's important to get behind the full message.
And I appreciate you sharing it, first and foremost, because there's a bigger ethos behind why you're building what you're building. It's not about, we mentioned before, I mentioned to you guys, family business, right? You're like, it's not really about the family. They are so humble and they're very respectful of the understanding, but family business doesn't mean certain things. It means two people who have controlling interests in their business as a family. And what I wanted to do today was just to show that the time period that they've been through during COVID, spending the time to learn not only the industry, but also practice what they preach, which is going out there and looking for customer discovery from a student perspective and from a teacher perspective, they got a chance to truly involve themselves in their own idea. By far, a lot of entrepreneurs that I've dealt with have not done that one thing, which is just go out there and go actually see if other people have the problem that you're willing to solve, or that you think you can solve. So you guys have done a great job in that area. What I wanna see is, real quickly as we end off, is to talk a little bit more about your ask. What do you need right now? What's most important for Teachagram to be able to grow, get off the ground, and become the actual technology and the solution for helping people learn anything?
Yeah, that's in my basket here. So for us, we can open on the App Store tomorrow. That's not a problem. We have our MVP ready. I think we really are cautious because we know that there's no two chances. And timing is very important. I think the faster that we can help, because during COVID, there was $3.7 trillion loss in income around the world. And everyone, 1.6 billion children that were taken away from schools, locked in homes, and now slowly being able to come out now as things get a little bit better. But the timing of the timing is really important right now, that we get the solution out as soon as possible. Finding the right kind of teachers, you know, we don't need lots of professors. We want people that are, you know, just like me and you, to get on and share a connection with someone and make a livable wage from that and have a nice connection with someone across the sea or maybe across the street. And so for right now, finding people that we align with is really important. I met a lot of people in this year and a half, and it's the most important thing is alignment. Finding people that believe what you believe, that people that won't change your vision, people that won't change your identity, and allowing you to stay the course that you're on and not shifting it to a different path. So we are speaking to VCs, speaking to seed investors, speaking to, we've done about $500,000 raised, and you know, a lot of that is towards the engineering side, you know, a lot of these things that needed to be funded, so on and so forth. But finding the right teachers for the platform is really important. Finding people that we align with is really important. We have a lovely team that I've been hesitating to expose too early, but they're packed with wonderful people. I couldn't be more blessed, and I'm very thankful that we've been able to come this far. And people, you know, it's less of what we have done, and more of how grateful we have been to meet the right people, meet people like you, and have this vision go as far as it has. So we're very grateful. We're very grateful Absolutely. For how this has gone so far.
Absolutely. So as we end off, I just want to say I'm happy you guys were able to make it here and share your story. I'm sure it's going to inspire a lot of people either here, either those who are watching online, or eventually those who are hearing more about your story as we keep going and seeing you guys grow. So thank you very much, Sorah and Magnus. So I'll leave it up for any questions at all.
Yes.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, go right ahead. Go right ahead.
So, you mentioned earlier that you wanted anyone to teach, right? But I feel like, my question is there like a sort of layout that a teacher can follow? So, for example, let's say somebody wants to teach graphic design or anything like that, right?
Yes.
But they just have that aspiration of teaching, but they actually don't know how to go throughout the process of teaching, right? So is there something set up for them to follow in order to?
Yeah, there's two parts, there's two answers to your question. The format itself is set up for your success. So when I say a lot of these other formats were archaic, what do I mean by that? I mean they have a lot of text, there's a tiny photo of you, and there's a video maybe or maybe not. And that order is in the wrong order. People want to know, who am I speaking with first and foremost? Everyone thinks that the first thing that you're supposed to see is your credentials, but what people really want to see is you in action. So the video I learned from teaching and helping other people become a teacher is the most important. So the platform itself promotes a quick vertical video, so it's all centered on you. And then the next thing is your profile photo, because it shows who you are. I mean, there's a lot of information that we can't even describe that we get from faces. And then the last thing is a block of text that usually is in the front. So that's one. Number two, yes, we are creating a system, and this is not like Facebook where everybody can make an account. You apply to be a teacher, your video and content is reviewed, and you are onboarded as a teacher. So we are working on ways to help people get set up and practice becoming a teacher before their launch on the platform. So, great question. Yeah.
Please.
So, you said you've been developing this app since like pre-COVID, and then I'm assuming probably a good chunk of your research was probably before like people like transferred to Zoom. So how would you think like how would you see the progression of online education change because of that? Do you think it hasn't improved?
Yeah, I think a lot of people use Zoom because it's currently the best solution. We actually met, I forgot her name, but there's
Isabel?
Yeah, from ARK Investments or whatever. They were a big investor in Zoom or something, and they asked me, why don't you use Zoom? You know, Zoom is great. Everyone else is using Zoom. And I said, well, I think everyone's using Zoom because it's currently the best thing out, but we believe that we can create a better video solution. We are working, there's like some things under wraps, and I'll share with you later too as well, but there's some things that we're doing with AI. One of the things that we're planning on doing with AI is right now you have to initiate your own escape or initiate your own rescue. What does that mean? You have to push the button, end the meeting, or you have to call 911. You have to do your own saving. Well, with our technology that we're working on is if you show signs of distress, especially in children that are learning online and they get frozen, if there's signs of distress, then it will initiate a response for you. Oh, would you like to end the call? Or do you feel uncomfortable? So that language is being worked on. But we initiate your saving. We initiate the end of the call or the end of the meeting. So things like that, we can do better that Zoom does not offer. So currently, even though Zoom is amazing, we think that we can do things specifically for education and for classrooms that is just simply not available yet. So hopefully that answers your question a little bit there.
No, I like the group here. It's very interesting.
It's my father.
I want to ask
our father,
you,
yeah.
You said there were $3.7 trillion lost
Yes.
And there were 1.6 billion children that lost a year of school. They
or more.
They need to all be helped to catch up.
Yes.
So, okay, let's take your gloves off and explain to us. Why don't you just show us? Okay? Because some of us get in, some of us don't.
Sure. My phone's on the table back there.
We just want to see. Okay, bottom line is, we almost lost $3.5 trillion from our hardworking citizens of the world. Okay, so how are you going to help? How are you going to fix this problem? Who can you help?
Yeah, we can help anyone with a smartphone. Yes, and then they can make $20 to $40 an hour. So that's, you know, like I said, I made $12,000 total in 2 months, so it can help anyone that has any type of skill set that is willing to help someone get better at math, get better at English, whatever their skill set is better set for. This is our platform. So I think you might recognize a little bit of the look. So you can teach here, you see their profile, you keep scanning.
Don't say everyone are, say everyone is.
You can keep going here. So you can teach a lot of different things here. And then if you click on their profile here, it'll open up. Their particular profile tells them a little bit of information about them. You can favorite them for finding them later. You can message them asking. Oh, that's the other thing that's really important about the platform. On other platforms, every interaction is for popularity, commenting, sharing, liking. But every interaction here is towards your business. So every time someone likes you, it saves them into a different list. So that's they're interested. If they message you, they're usually messaging you about your lessons. If you're sharing them, you're like, oh, I think this would be great for someone else. And then you share their content to someone else that would probably like to purchase your lessons. So as far as a teacher, it's the best tool that you can have. It organizes scheduling, payment solutions, advertising, everything that you could possibly ever want to do, it's already taken care of for you. So all you need to do is show up online and teach on time. And for the students, it's the best thing possible because they're getting as much exposure to their pre-selected interest right off the bat. So hopefully that answers that. Yes. Yeah,
like
yeah.
How is that organized to like show? Is it like similar to like TikTok algorithm?
Yeah, there's heavy conversation on the AI of the front end. But to answer your question, is you pre-select your interest. So I want to learn about cooking. I want to learn about math. So whatever you want to learn about, and then it will customize a feed for you, populate it. It'll show it to you. You go ahead and go through random ones. It'll give the most exposure to teachers as possible, which exposure is everything for a teacher. You go ahead and click the lesson. As you can see, there's a YouTube video, so you can, if you have YouTube links, you plug them in. If you're already on TikTok, you plug in your TikTok there. And you go ahead and select your lesson, so you can schedule in here as well. So yes, the feed is customized for your pre-selected interests. Yes.
It's amazing.
Thank you. And then, was there another one or?
Any other questions at all? Yeah, please.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit more about your MVP tournament? Did you decide to build your own team or like hire contractors?
Yeah, so we built our own team and we have our team from all US based. And that was important for us is that we really wanted to help the US and it was just important for us to build within the US. So yes, we hired our own people. Yes, yeah. Your question.
So TikTok makes money through ads.
Correct.
So how would Teachagram make
money? Yes, this is a wonderful question. So Teachagram, we don't have any ads on Teachagram. We can put them on there, but we don't want to. So on the front, so let's say you say first, how much, we ask you as Teachagram, how much would you like to make? Well, I like to go home after every lesson, maybe like $15, $16 in my pocket. Okay, you will get $15 or $16, but we will put a small fee on the front end of it, and then we will collect that fee and show that fee up front. So maybe it'll be $17 or some odd cents that's in the front. That's one way. The other way is as you accumulate money as a teacher, it will sit in like an escrow account. And then for every $100 you earn towards $2,000, it will shrink it by 1%. So you have a 20% in the back. If you have $2,000 in your bank account or in your escrow account and you transfer it to your bank, it's a 0% fee there. So those are the two ways that we, as Teachagram, that we float our business. But yes, we don't charge anything upfront. We don't have like a monthly accruing membership. As of now, we don't have any onboarding fee. We don't have a sign-up fee. We don't have any of that. So we help you get started as quickly as possible. If you're strapped for cash, you don't have any money, you can still get started on Teachagram. Yes.
So probably one thing they're probably asking themselves is all the other platforms you have to try to monetize.
Yes.
And become popular. Now, yes. You've mentioned that that's not the goal at all, but you can generate influence on Teachagram.
Yeah, because you know, Uber has, to answer my father's question earlier, Uber has like 3.5 million drivers. There's 7 million listings, but 2.9 million hosts on Airbnb. There's a limit. There's a lot of people that need to make money right now. I mean, the surge of people that try to do drop shipping, and that, you know, that didn't work out for a lot of my friends. Then they're all going to be traders, and then you know that didn't really work out on Robinhood, and everybody's trying to figure out some way to make some extra cash. And the one thing that they want to know is, if I put my time into it, if I put X amount of hours into it, if I learn how to do this, will I make some money back? You know, not even a ton, but some money back. And you know, what are the guaranteed money? You can be a pizza delivery guy, you can be Airbnb. That's actually pretty hard to get set up on. Uber, you can get on Uber, you can get on Lyft. But with us, what a lot of UCI students here, we don't have a car, right? With us, all you need is your cell phone and a willingness to teach. And who are you teaching? Are you teaching some super smart people, geniuses everywhere? You're teaching regular people like you and me how to get better at something that you're pretty good at. Whether you're good at robotics or you're good at math or you're good at fishing, whatever you're good at, you advertise it on there and the world will find you and you have your lessons there. And if you taught 7 hours, you get paid for those 7 hours. You don't, there's a lot of these other sites, there's a lot of free stuff. No, you get paid for your time. I believe everybody's time is valuable, and one-on-one should be paid for. That's my belief. So we are protecting that right now. Yes?
So as a student, it's an app, so it's like all the training going through, like I think it's going through like a credit card.
Credit card you put in, correct, yes. So currently, with the way things are, we are allowed to have our own credit card system for Teachagram right now, with the way that things are set up with Apple and the way that things are set up on Android. So yes, we were very happy to be able to do that. So we handle all the payments, we handle all the video, everything's in app, everything's done by Teachagram, so you can feel safe and secure about your connection and your payment and everything. Yes.
Awesome. If you don't have passion.
Yes. Oh, sorry.
No. I just want to make sure you guys know, as entrepreneurs, you don't have passion about your company, pay attention. This is exactly what you need in order to make sure people understand exactly what you're saying. So I love it, Magnus. Thank you.
Yes.
So you were putting an emphasis on like the one-on-one communication, right?
Strong emphasis, yes.
As well, I would like to know like how would be, or are you thinking about also building a community within the app? So I know that a lot of platforms like Skillshare, right? Like you take a class on Skillshare.
Yes. Yeah. I'm an anti-course guy. I don't like people saying, oh, you know, buy my $900 course, buy my $1,200 course. Okay, who here bought a $2,000 course?
My high school teacher did.
Okay, are you your high school teacher? Come on. No, so what I'm saying is we're real people, right? We spend money. Who has a Netflix account, right? We have accounts. We pay for things. We buy things. We shop. We are real consumers and real producers of this, well, future producers of this world. We're real people. There's a lot of like, you know, people that are like, we're imagining that exists. Like, oh, they're going to buy this. They're going to sell. No, we are real people. Okay. If you, right now we're beginning the school year. If you are near the end of your finals and you feel really stuck and you've watched like 100 YouTube videos and you just have this one question and this guy's like, I will charge you $15 for this hour. I will answer every question you have. I'm this qualified because of this reasons. Watch my video. Oh, you like the way I teach? Wouldn't you go ahead and do that? Isn't that worth your grade? Or would you just be like, no, I'm just going to keep scrolling through YouTube aimlessly. I'm still going to like go through Google aimlessly, and I'm going to try to figure it out and hope I wing it, you know? A lot of people, there's many times in my life where I needed help and I needed someone to answer me a question for something as simple as plumbing. Right? I'm not a very good plumber. I'm just gonna, you know, say it. I'm just not. So anytime there's a leak, I don't know what to do. And when I watch YouTube, some, you know, 480p thing and some guys explaining it and talks for like 12 minutes, and then 3 minutes at the end he wants to sell me his course. I'm tired of it. Okay? I just wanna, let me give you some money, give me the answers. Tell me what I wanna know. Tell me what I wanna know about fly fishing. Nobody goes into, oh, maybe I'll go into fly fishing. People usually are into it and they say, I really don't know which one to buy. No one will tell me the truth. And that's not on any YouTube forum or any on Google forum. So let me just talk to an expert. So one-on-one is very important. There's a lot of what I call one-to-one, which is a transfer. One group to one group, one person to one group, a transfer of information. I believe on one-on-one, which is an exchange, usually equivalent exchange. You should be paid for your special knowledge that you took a lot of time to get. You know what I'm saying?
You don't need to shop.
I don't like shopping. I'm going to tell you. I don't like trying on things. I don't like shopping.
You don't need an office.
You know, I have no fashion sense. This is why you think I'm fashionable. Everything is one color, okay? It's all navy. Don't look at the shoes. They're black. I know you're not supposed to mix navy and black. Yeah. I already did it. It's too late. So if someone would just tell me, if I was in the mall and I would say, hey, this is H&M. This is supposed to be a hip store. What do I pick? I have a very important day tonight, and I don't want to look like a slob. You know, there's many applications to Teachagram. Yeah. It's endless. The leisure education section of it is the biggest part, right? Because there's like the, you know, academic section, which is, you know, we need to get done. Yeah. But there's the leisure side of it. I just want to know, you know, if you've, I have a lot of friends that love online gaming. They've spent like thousands of dollars trying to figure out how to become top tier in their like online games. I'm sure they would love to have a one-on-one coach time. So there's a lot of power in one-on-one. And I refuse to dilute it. So as far as community goes, one of the cool things that we're working on for 1.0 is, let's say you find an English teacher or a math teacher that you like, or a skateboarder. And you're like, oh, I want to look at other skateboarders kind of like this. You click on the community button and it'll open up a wide variety of other skateboarders that you can select from, ranked from, you know, most popular to, you know, I guess least popular. I don't like to use that word. So we'll just say from most popular down. So yes, that would be our community. I believe there's a lot of communities out there. You know, I don't have a Facebook, I don't have any social media, but there's a lot of communities. How connected and how close are you? Like my dad says, how many people on Facebook are gonna come pick you up when your car breaks down? You probably got their phone number, right? So, yeah, or Uber, technology will come save you. Yeah, so, yes, yes.
So is this?
And then yes. Yeah, we're not really here to, you know, get our pitchforks ready and attack the, you know, institutions. We're like, you know, we don't like you guys, you know. Yeah. And a lot of times it doesn't work because what you want is accreditation. You want your, like, you just go to college here because it's fun. You just like to hang out here. You like to, you know, spend money and hang out here. You're looking to get your degree so you can go say, hey, world, I've done it. And then you go work in a wonderful career where you can provide the world a lot of wonderful stuff. But without that degree, without those certifications that we provide you, because there's a university that's like free on the internet somewhere, and nobody does it because there's no accreditation. So what's the point? You go 4 years there, and what happens? Nothing. That's what happens. So if it's an argument about content versus certification, content, I'm confident winning about content, because a lot of my friends, I'm not gonna call you out, but my friend, you know, computer science major, didn't learn how to make a website from school. You pay one lesson, you probably start working on how to make a website. So I think I'm king of content there, queen of content there. but it's as far as accreditation, I don't want to, that's something that has been there for a long time. I've been helped by it, I respect it, and that's gonna stay there. So we're not here to come after the taxis. Yeah. As they say, we're here to just have Uber going on.
Yeah, and just think about it real quickly. Just think about it. It's not about attacking education. It's about what do you want to learn? Like, yeah.
No one
said that at all.
No
but
one said that.
Maybe one day. But it's about what do you want to learn? Like, you can't learn everything in school. And even if you could, you won't have the time. So when do you have the time to learn? Sometimes is when you're not in your academic setting and you just want to learn, like, cooking or manga or whatever it may be, and how can you get started? Just get started. Do you want to continue going down the rabbit hole of social media and all the different channels that you can eventually find, or would you like to put in your interest, get exactly what you asked for, pay for what you want, and receive value?
Yeah, the most valuable thing in the world is time, because that's what we know is for sure limited. So if you save someone time, that must be the second most valuable thing for sure. Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. So for advertising, we've been asked, you know, you want to do YouTube ads, you want to do Google ads, you want to, what do you want to do? I believe in advertising for certain things. I think certain things don't really need advertising. Like, for example, if we have a lot, for some reason, a lot of English teachers, I know Taiwan loves native English teachers, so maybe I'll run a Google ad there, or I'll talk to my friend in Taiwan and Tainan, or Taipei too. So that's one. But this is not something I'm going to just, you know, blast on the internet and say, everyone sign up, yeah. Everyone take a lesson. We didn't take this long to do it in that kind of fashion. Yeah. I'm here to learn about each teacher. Each teacher, I call them, right? I Zoom call, I say, hi, you know, I heard that you want to be a teacher. You know, I'm the founder here. What's up? What do you want to teach? And then go over their concerns, go over anything, because that connection is really important to me. There will come a point where I can't do that anymore, but until I can't, yeah. Until I, you know, drop from exhaustion, that's why we wake up so early, right? You know, we wake up pretty early. It's because there is no replacement for one-on-one, yeah. Even for that. There's no replacement. I mean, let me give an example. If I went around and I was a UCI alumni here, and I go talk to people, and I talk to them each individually, this room would be exploding out the sides, because I personally met someone, had an emotional connection with them, transferred sincerity, and then, just like your friends on your birthday, they will be there, right? But what about the ad? We advertise, 30,000 students, maybe 60,000 total. Is 30,000 people here? Is 10% of 30,000 people here? No. Why? Because it works, but it doesn't. It works on the seventh time. Right? I mean, we put that out four times, right? It works on like the seventh time. The 100th time you see a Coca-Cola ad, maybe you're like,
oh, I want to cook.
Maybe that sugary drink, darn you. Maybe I'll try it out. That's how that works. So it does work, but it doesn't work. The best thing is, if I knew you personally, just like I know my friend personally there, he texts me, I don't see it. Where's the address? Where's the invite? I said, I'll pick you up. Let's just go. Right? That's a friend. That's a real community. That's a real community. That's a community of one, way more useful than a community of 1,000 people that won't pick up my phone. That doesn't know about my mom. Doesn't know about my dad. You know what was the most interesting thing? I know we're talking a lot here. You know what was the most interesting thing about teaching? I was started out with teaching English. I always said, what do you want to learn? And they said, we want to learn English. I'm like, okay, I speak English. Let me do the best I can. Okay, tell me how to speak like an American. I'm like, I'm doing it. I'm doing it right now, you know? And
so funny.
The children eventually said what they really wanted to say is, you know, have you ever watched a real basketball game in America? I said, yeah, I've watched some basketball games. You know this player? I said, no, but we can YouTube him. And we would YouTube him, and he would be talking, and he's like, I don't understand. And I explain what he's saying. What they really wanted was a connection, someone to really care about them, cater what they want to learn. That's why I don't like courses. How do you know what I want to learn? Let me tell you what I want to learn, Mr. Chef, okay? So there's a lot of wonderful things I believe will come out of Teachagram. It starts always out like this. We've done this a lot of times, many times. It always starts like this. A small room of people listening, engaging. Maybe some of you will wait and watch the progress. Maybe some of you will come talk to us. And then from there it grows. From there it grows. Not from the guy that doesn't want to show up. It's always the people that show up that make things grow. So.
With that being said,
yes.
Share as much as you can about Teachagram.
Right, yeah.
This is not going to go away. We're going to be talking about it for a while, and we're going to learn a little bit more as much as the updates you guys give us.
Yeah.
And hopefully, very soon, we can speak about the growth and the process. And so for everyone here, I really appreciate it. Thanks for coming. And let's have some food and talk.
Yeah, thank you for coming. Appreciate it.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yeah, it was good to see
Absolutely,
you.
Absolutely, brother. Good
thank
to see you, man.
You.